ॐ गणानां त्वा गणपतिं हवामहे कविं कवीनामुपमस्व्यवस्तमम् ज्येष्ठराजं ब्रह्मणां ब्रह्मणस्पद आनः शृण्वन्नूतिभिः सीदसादनम् ॐ श्रीमहागणाधिपतये नमः ॐ वृषभं चर्षणीनां विश्वरूपमदाभ्यं बृहस्पतिं वरेण्यम् ॐ तद्विष्णोः परमं पदं सदा पश्यन्ति सूरयः दिवि वचक्षुराततम् ॐ श्रीं ह्रीं ज्योतिर्ब्राह्माय नमः ॐ केन् एव्रिबडी से हरे राम कृष्ण थ्री टाइम्स आफ्टर मी ॐ हरे राम कृष्ण हरे राम कृष्ण हरे राम कृष्ण ओके
एग्जांपल्स
आर डीपीएचएस विल डू एग्जांपल्स डीपीएचएस लेटर ओके सो टुडे आल्सो विल बी एग्जांपल्स ऑन द क्लास दिस विल बी अ शॉर्ट क्लास वन आवर क्लास एनी एग्जाम चार्ट्स यू वांट टू सी Yeah, give me the data. Actually, if you want to turn it on, okay. You can turn it on.
August 13th.
Yeah.
2001.
August 30th. 2001. Yeah.
12:29 p.m.
12:29 p.m. Place.
Lowell.
LOWELL Lowell, Massachusetts. Okay.
Parents have concern.
One second, let me just save it. What is the. How should I save it? Okay. Okay, this is. Yeah, I am putting it there only. Okay. Come up now. So August 30, 2001, 12:29 p.m. The time zone is Eastern Daylight Saving Time, 4 hours west of GMT. The place is Lowell, Massachusetts, USA. 71 degrees 90 minutes west, 42 degrees 38 minutes north. Okay.
Kid had asthma from childhood.
Asthma from childhood.
Yes. Uh-huh. And he was on medication single year for last 3 years.
Asthma since childhood.
Yes.
Then on medication. Okay.
On medication on for daily basis.
He is on medication on a daily basis. Okay.
And he had some speech problems till 3 years.
Speech problems.
And then slow growth now, that's what the problem they are seeing is
slow growth.
Yeah, and then even the doesn't listen to the teachers and like that.
Okay.
So even they got complaints from the school also that he doesn't.
That is slow. Okay. Okay. So we are seeing this chart. The issue is this kid had asthma problem since childhood, and he has been on a daily medication, an asthma medication, and the growth seems to be slow, the speech seems to be problematic, very slow, and did not pick up until 3 years of age, and even now understanding instructions and following instructions seems to be a little weak, and there was a complaint from the school and the parents are concerned. So they want to have an idea of what may be in store for this kid. Okay. Okay, let's see. The Lagna is Libra, 27th degree of Libra. And are there any salient features that you notice right away when you see the chart? Any interesting features?
Saturn
8th house has Saturn, but he is Yokarka. Okay, what else? Third house has two malefics. Okay, third house has Mars and Ketu, and out of them, Mars is actually in Gandhanta. Mars is a Marka for this chart, he is the second and seventh lord, and he is in the third house. Normally, Mars in the third house is a good thing, but when he is Marka, second and seventh lord, his being in the third is not so good. And he is especially in Gandhanta. He is in the Mula Gandhanta. He is in the second degree of Mula, second degree of Sagittarius. So Mars is in Gandhanta. So one dosha straight away is Mars in Gandhanta. So Gandhanta dosha santi has to be done. Okay. How is the rest of the strength of the chart? Any other things? Lagna Lord Venus seems to be well placed, right? Lagna Lord Venus is in a friendly sign. And not friendly sign, but he is in a fruitful sign, Cancer. And he is in a quadrant. And Moon is aspecting him. So Lagna Lord and 10th Lord, Moon and Venus, they are aspecting each other from quadrants, both being in quadrants. So Lagna Lord is quite strong. So Lagna Lord's strength is there. And Lagna is from Lagna, the 6th Lord Jupiter, he is afflicted by Rahu. Basically, Jupiter is afflicted by Rahu. That is one weakness. Guru Chandal Yoga is there.
And Mars aspect.
And yeah, Mars Ketu, Jupiter, Mars Ketu, basically all of them in the all of them are reasonably close. So Rahu Ketu is afflicting Mars and Rahu is afflicting Jupiter within like 7-8 degrees in both the cases. So that is one problem. The Gandhanta Mars, the Marka, is aspecting Jupiter, and also Jupiter is with Rahu. There is Guru Chandala Yoga. So 6th Lord is afflicted, and moreover, the Rogapada, A6, is there. So there is some problem, but let us see the Trimshamsa, and actually let us first see the Siddhamsa. The chart of learning things, where it is learning mathematics, physics, or generally following instructions. Any grasping ability and learning ability is seen from the D24 chart. If somebody has learning desire, learning problem, learning difficulty, there has to be something bad going on in the D24. Otherwise, it is not possible. How much leeway do we have in the Siddhamsa? That is the first thing we should check. 2 seconds earlier, the Lagna would be previous sign, Aries. So the Siddhamsa Lagna we have is Taurus, but it could very well be Aries. Okay, which one is more likely given the background that he has learning problem, he is unable to learn fast?
Pardon
me?
The current Lagna.
Yeah. Okay, so you think that the ability to learn is from the 4th house. So you think that the 4th house is strong here. So it is unlikely. Okay.
If you move it, it will become 5th house. And 5th house is Jupiter.
Yeah.
For primary education, you have to see the 4th house.
Primary education, you see the 4th house, but 5th house is the basic intelligence of the person.
Okay.
If the person is unable to follow instructions, apart from learning, the basic intelligence is weakened. So there has to be some undesirable feature with respect to the basic intelligence. Right? So Jupiter in the 4th house, is it really good or bad? Well, Jupiter is a good planet, but he is the 8th and 11th lord. He is a functional malefic in the Rasi chart. In the D24 chart. Even in the Rasi chart, he is a malefic. He is a malefic, 3rd and 6th lord of problems and obstacles, and he is giving Guru Chandala Yoga. And such a Jupiter, when he happens to be a functional malefic in Siddhamsa also, and he is in the 4th house of learning, is it auspicious for learning or not so good? It's not so good, right?
Okay.
So even though Jupiter is a good planet, his placement in the 4th is not good. On the other hand, with the other chart that you with the other chart, if you take Aries as the Lagna, then Jupiter would be in the fifth house of intelligence, and he is the ninth lord, the ninth and twelfth lord. He is a rank benefic. He is a great benefic for this Siddhanta chart, and his placement in the fifth house would be a blessing. Whereas this person is not so lucky, so it is.
When you say slow growth here, is the growth in learning, respect to learning or learning?
Understanding instructions, following the instructions. Right, he is just only 7 years. He is just 7 years. But so far the promise hasn't been there. Okay. One second. Let's also, while we look at it, let's open the dasa. What dasa is running right now? What is the dasa we should use for this chart? Lagna is not in Vargottama. Nothing special applies. So regular Vimshottari we will use. And as per the Vimshottari dasa, when he was born it was Sandasa, but right now it is Moondasa that is running. Okay, so Moondasa, when Moondasa is running, there are some problems in learning, right? With Moondasa running, there are some problems in learning. Learning is not smooth. Now, would it make sense if Aries is the Lagna? Not really, because if Aries is Lagna, Cancer would be the fourth house of learning, and Moon would be the lord of it, aspecting fourth house. So, fourth lord in a quadrant, aspecting the fourth house, should be. Even though he is in a bad house, he is in an inimical house, Saturn sign, still it should basically be fine. And the fact that his friend Jupiter, he is in the fifth house of intelligence. So he should be reasonably intelligent, reasonably able to follow the instructions. What we know about the person does not make sense. On the other hand, taking this Lagna, the current Lagna, Taurus, does it make sense that there are some problems in learning? Third lord in the ninth house. He is in Badhakasthana. If you take Taurus as the Lagna, he is the Badhaka lord. Right? So, being the Badhaka lord, if he gives some problems in learning, it's not too impossible. He is the Badhaka lord. He has Argala on the eighth house of troubles, etc. So, there is some possibility of problems. And apart from it, the basic weakness of the chart is Lagna Lord Venus, even though he is in the 11th house exalted, he is afflicted by nodes and he is also aspected by Mars, Maraka Mars. And the 5th house of intelligence has Mars. Is Mars a benefic or malefic for this chart? Functionally. Is he a benefic or malefic? Pardon me? Yeah, he is the 7th and 12th lord. But based on all the basics I taught you earlier, is he a functional benefic or malefic? What is your answer?
Yes,
exactly. 12th house is a neutral house, and Kendras, for benefics, natural benefics, they are bad houses, but for natural malefics, they are neutral houses. They are not good, they are neutral. So, overall, Mars is a neutral planet, functionally. But he happens to be a Maraka. And the fact that he, such a Mars, is in the fifth house, and in general, he is not a very fruitful planet. He is not like Jupiter or Venus or Mercury. So, he is not a very good planet, and here also he is not that good. So, his placement in the fifth house is not so auspicious for being very intelligent. But the saving grace is Lagna Lord Venus from exaltation sign is aspecting it. So there is some saving grace, but in general it's not that good. And the fifth lord Mercury, he is in the sixth house. It's not that bad. It is actually Dhimanta Yoga. Fifth lord being in the sixth house can give Dhimanta Yoga. So Mercury is not that bad, but technically fifth lord is in a Dosthana. So there is some another weakness. In addition to a not so good planet being in the fifth house, there is another weakness. But what is worse is fourth house is even worse compared to fifth house. It has the eighth lord and it has Mandiri. And the fourth lord's son, he is in the second house. Second house is not really conducive to, it's not an important house for learning. Second house is actually a Marakasthana. So the fourth lord is in a Marakasthana and is aspecting the eighth house. sun. So all these factors are, and also if you look at the fourth house, which aroha padarthas are in the fourth house? What does Asik show? A tangible struggle. A tangible obstacle. Overcoming obstacles, and obstacles are shown by sixth house. So a tangible obstacle is shown by that. Now if you look at the dashas, for the last 2 years or 3 years rather, for the last 2.5 years, what is the dasha running? By the way, just for those who are following on the internet, I opened the D24 Narayan dasha and I changed it to start the dashas from Scorpio instead of the default, which is Libra. For D24, we take the 12th house as the default, 12th house as the seed. So 12th house is 12th rad is Mercury. Mercury is in Libra, so you start the D24 Narayan dasha from Mercury. But that is the overall evolution of the person. You can do that, but I am more interested in the specific learning. So for that, you can take the 4th lord to see all the formal learning at school, etc. You can look at the 4th lord of the Rasi chart as the seed in D24. When I did it, the 4th lord in Rasi chart is Shani, Saturn. He is a Scorpio in the D24 chart. So taking Scorpio as the seed, we get basically after Scorpio the chart till 2005, Sagittarius the chart will start. Why is going Scorpio is a fixed sign, instead of going every sixth progression is going straight Scorpio, Sagittarius, Capricorn, like that, because Saturn is there, Saturn exception applies. Anyway, Sagittarius the chart is running right now for the last 3 years. This is an important period, I mean from the age of 4 basically. From the age of 4 till the age of 12, this is an important age when the basic education is provided for the kid. And during this period, unfortunately, Sagittarius dasha is running. Is Sagittarius a good dasha? Well, not really, because it is the 8th house. It is the 8th house of troubles, tensions, and it is the 12th house from Aruh Lagna. Pardon me?
Also is in the Ganata house.
In the Rasi.
Rasi.
In the Rasi chart. But here in the D24, it is simply the 8th house of tension and anxiety and power and ups and downs. And from Arudha Lagna, it is 12th house. From Moon, the mind, again it is 12th house. So either way, it's not such a good house. Moreover, Gudika is there. And moreover, the lord of that house is afflicting the 4th house of basic education. So the dasha of the 8th house is running and its lord is affecting the basic education. So the fact that he is having trouble receiving basic education and doing well in the basic education makes some sense. There is some anxiety relating to that. It's simply because Sagittarius dasha is running. Unfortunately, is there any possibility of progress, relief right now? Not really, I mean. Pardon me? Fourth Lord Sun is aspecting, right.
Sun is the savior.
Of course, so many guys are aspecting. Mars, Venus, Rahu, Ketu. Venus aspect is also good. But overall, it does not look too good. From Lagna, from Aru Lagna, from Moon, all the three Lagnas, it is not so auspicious, that particular house. And its Lord is also not so well placed. Had it been in the sixth house or something, there would have been a Vipritha Rajoga, some tension, and then things finally working out okay. So things don't seem that good for the next 5 years.
Almost his education will be
done. Well, not really, just 12 years.
Yeah.
All the basic education. So it doesn't seem that good. Right. Now, how is the... And let us see, just as an exercise, I want to see Pathgari Samandhas, which we did a...
Next
class
I do
Capricorn, right. It's the Badhaka, Badhakasthana's dasha. And it's Lord Saturn, he's a Yokaraka, but Saturn is in the 7th house. And Saturn, for Saturn, 7th house is not such an auspicious house to be. And Saturn is in A5. A5 is, what is
A5?
Yeah. Recognition, etc. For that, Saturn is an inauspicious planet to be in J5. But the good thing is, Saturn is also Yokarka. So, being Yokarka, he can actually give some relief. But still, it is the Bhadrasthana. So there are some weaknesses also. So it is a mixed dasa. It is not as bad as the Sagittarius dasa because of the Bhadaka thing. But it is likely to be a better dasa. His learning is likely to improve. Basically, he may be in the right environment compared to now. Why am I saying right environment? Moon is the karaka of nourishment. He is the karaka of mother, right? So in D24, and it is also applying the mind. So because moon is in that particular sign, moon can basically provide the right environment and right compassionate environment for learning. Whereas Sagittarius is more fiery. It is Jupiter's sign. So, and Aruh Lagna is also there. So there may be, yeah, a new beginning. People may understand his status correctly and give him the right environment, and things may, as a result of it, things may be relatively better. He may be recognized for his achievement, which is in tune with his the expectations because of his. Well, that's too soon. But overall, until 2013, it doesn't look too good. This person's learning does not look too promising. Now let us. What was I saying? Oh, I wanted to show just experiment Padgar Samandhas. If you look at the Padgar Samandhas of Venus, Lagna Lord, because Lagna Lord is like the foundation of the chart. Who are the planets who are actually cooperating with Venus? I thought I mentioned them a few times. I didn't. Okay. There are so many samandhas, relationships between planets, like friend, enemy, good friend, good enemy, not good enemy, but worst enemy, bad enemy. Like that, we have these classifications. Like that, this is another kind of samandha. The samandhas are for each planet, there are some planets which are pachakas, some which are bodhakas, some which are karakas, and some which are vedakas. So these are the planets who basically cooperate with that planet in different ways. And basically work along with that planet. These are like the co-workers who have a certain influence on the planet. Similarly, there are certain houses. Patikasthana, Bodhakasthana, Karakasthana and Vedakasthana. So there are some houses and there are some planets. And planets are based on the Naisargika relationship. For example, for Venus, the Naisargika Pachaka is Moon. By the way, what is Pachaka? The literal meaning of Pachaka is the one who prepares, who ripens, who cooks. The word pach, the verb pach, the dhatu pach, from that the Hindi word pakana comes basically. Pakane wala basically. Pachaka literally means pakane wala. And also another meaning is ripening. And of course cooking and ripening are not really too different, not that different. They are basically the processes through which something is converted to something which is ready. Ready for consumption. Similarly, Pachaka of a Graha, he basically works with that planet so that the results are ripened. So he basically hastens the coming of the results. Bodhaka means teller, the one who tells, the one who explains, explainer. He is like a teacher. He is like the Bodhaka planet. He tries to tell the planet. No, you should give this result. Think about it. Like that, basically, he is trying to convince. Guidance, counselor, basically. Whereas Pachaka is one who basically enables it to transform. And Karaka is? It comes from the word, the Hindi word Karna, Karane Wala. So he is actually the one who gets it done. Who basically, explaining is one thing, and preparing the situation so that it can be transformed is another thing. Creating circumstances conducive to cooking is different. But doing is actually more important. So Karaka is the most important planet. But of course, all the three to varying degrees cooperate with the activity. Finally, Naisargika Vedaka. Vedaka means the one who creates obstacles. Vedha, who creates obstacles. So that you will have to work even harder to get it done. So that is Vedaka. So these are the four relationships. These are called Pachakadi. Adi means etc. Pachakadi Sambandhas. Pachaka etc. relationships. So for Mercury Venus, in Johora, you can sit on a planet and you can say relationships, Patagadi relationships of this planet. So for Venus, the natural Naisargika Pataka is Moon. Moon is the one who will basically create the circumstances relating to Venus, basically mind. And then the Naisargika Bodhaka is Mercury. Mercury is a friend of Venus, and Venus basically, he is the one, Venus' job is to give happiness, to give pleasure. And Mercury, by learning and understanding things, by creating an avagahana, creating an understanding of things, Mercury basically tells Venus how to be happy, how to be pleased. Whereas Karaka, the one who does things, that is Saturn. So Saturn is the Karaka for working hard. So basically he actually does all the hard work so that the happiness can come. And who gives Vedha to Venus? Sun, the king. This is fixed in all charts. The Naisargikas are always fixed. But the dynamic thing is, based on the chart, there is a sthana, Pataka sthana, which is a particular house from Venus. The second house is Pataka sthana from Venus. The sixth house is Bodhaka sthana from Venus, and so on. So based on that, here there is no planet in the Karaka sthana from Venus, and the Bodhaka sthana from Venus happens to be Leo. So for a Lagna Lord, the Bodhaka sthana happens to be the house that is supposed to counsel the Lagna Lord on giving his results, on strengthening this chart. That house happens to be the fourth house of learning, afflicted by eighth Lord Jupiter. That to be an enemy. When you tell an enemy, and Lagna Lord and eighth Lord, their agendas are poles apart. Eighth Lord wants to spoil things, and Lagna Lord wants to give things. Similarly, Venus and Jupiter are natural enemies. So when such an enemy is entrusted with the job of explaining how to do Venus job to Venus, it's not conducive. And Patakasthana is empty. The Vedha, the house of trouble, is occupied by Sun, the fourth lord of learning. So it's not a good relationship. Had the fourth lord been in Patakasthana or something, or Patakasthana, it would have been more auspicious. Now let us take the relationship, the Patakadi relationships on the fourth lord Sun. Sun is the fourth lord of learning, right? So, what are the relationships of Sun? So, let's ignore the Naisargika. Let's focus more on the dynamic. So, what are the relationships on Sun? There are all the relationships, all the Bodhaka, Karaka, all the houses are empty. But the one that is interesting is, one that is occupied is Scorpio, the Patakasthana. The Patakasthana is the house of ripening the results. It contains Saturn. That is actually auspicious. Saturn is a Yokkaraka. So Yokkaraka having the Pataka Sambandha with the fourth world of learning is auspicious. Only problem is Sun and Saturn don't get along that well. That's the only problem. Otherwise, it's not that bad. But it's not great also. Had there been a friend of Sun who's in a Karakasthana or Bodhakasthana, that would have been very auspicious for learning. And now let us take Mercury. Why Mercury? What is important? What is the importance of Mercury? Why do I want to look at Mercury? He is the fifth lord of learning. Now, the Bodhaka for him is Venus. That is auspicious. Oh, sorry. I was looking at it wrong. The Bodhaka for Mercury is Moon. Is that good? Yes, Moon is the fourth lord. Oh, actually, he is not fourth lord. He is the third lord. So he is not really an important planet. So anyway, so Moon being in the Bodhakasthana is neither very beneficial nor very malefic. And Saturn is in Scorpio, and he is in the Patakasthana. So again, Saturn is coming good. So if you look at both fourth lord and fifth lord, Saturn is either Pataka or Bodhaka or some good sambandha with both of them. And he is the Yokkaraka. So So Saturn is actually a savior. Based on this relationship, Saturn is a savior. Apart from it, we saw earlier that he is the Yokarka, he is the dispositor of moon sign, he is in the 11th from Aru Lagna, he is in the A5. So Saturn is actually an important planet. If we are talking about any remedies, Venus, of course, being the Lagna Lord, weak Lagna Lord affected by nodes, he can be worshipped. But more importantly, Saturn, the Yokarka, who is aspecting Lagna, who is aspecting the 4th house, and having Pathaka, being the Pathaka of the 4th Lord and 5th Lord, he is actually the key planet. Saturn should be worshipped. Now, let us go to another chart, D30. How is D30? Yeah. Well, let's not look at Narayana. Just look at Vimshottari. How is Vimshamsa? Are there any big problems in the Vimshamsa? Where are Rahu and Ketu? They are in a Vayu Rashi. They are in Saturn sign. If Rahu and Ketu are in, see, either Rahu or Ketu are any serious afflictions in the chart. If they occur in Jalatattva, it is basically Jalatattva is weakened. If it is Prithvitattva, Prithvitattva weakened, right? So we are looking at the weakness, the vulnerability of tissues. So which element is weakened by Rahu Ketu's presence? Vayu. And what does Vayu show in the body? Flow of things. What kind? For example, nervous. There are two main things for the show, the Vayu, Vata in the body. One is the nervous system, all the flow of signals in the nerves. The other is the flow of the blood. But again, flow of the blood is also partially Jalatattva. Any blood related things will also show in the Jalatattva. But if there is a flowing of the blood, it can be Vayutattva. But bottom line is, there is a Vayutattva problem. So there can actually be a nervous problem. There can be a vulnerability in the system. There can be a deformity or some problem, systemic problem physically, which is expressing as a result of some subconscious dosha, some subconscious Ayurvedic dosha in the body relating to flow of signals in the nervous system. Basically, there is a nervous debility, nervous disorder. And who is the planet for nervous, all the communication in the nervous system? Which planet shows that?
Moon.
Moon is blood. Mind, but second, not really. See, in terms of the tissues themselves, the nerve tissue is shown by Mars. Saturn is the muscle tissue, right? See, again, Sun is bone. Moon is blood. Mercury is the plasma. The Mercury is the skin, etc. And Jupiter is the maida. Jupiter is fat. Saturn is muscle. Mars is nerve tissue. We covered everybody. Venus is semen, the reproductive tissue. So these are the tissues. And Rahu and Ketu are, they don't show any tissue, but they show depletion of all tissues. So these are the tissues in the body physically. But in terms of the functionality of the tissues, who shows the communication of the job of the nervous system, which is to communicate things? The communication of signals within the nervous system, who shows that? Mercury, the karaka of the communication. Right? And how is Mercury placed in this chart? He is in the 8th house. Pardon me?
8th and 12th.
Right. Yeah, he has an exchange with Venus and Mercury. But the thing is, the bottom line is, if you take Mercury as Lagna to see the nervous communication, what are the arugulas on Mercury? Venus and Mercury have an argala, fifth house argala, secondary argala, but it is obstructed by Saturn. What, any other argalas? Second house argala, nothing. Fourth house argala, is there any? Yes. Rahu and Ketu's Argalas are counted in reverse. So if you want to see Rahu's and Ketu Argala, you count backwards. So if you take Mercury, if you count backwards, 1, 2, 3, 4, Rahu and Ketu have Argala and Mercury. So Mercury, who shows communication of signals in the nervous system, he has Argala from Rahu and Ketu. Is it obstructed? No. Anybody to obstruct has to be in this house, 10th house. I mean, for a normal planet, it should be in the 10th house, or for Rahu Ketu in the 10th house. Those are the obstructing houses, empty. 10th house has only Rahu Ketu, 4th house has no planet. So, it's an unobstructed Argala. The Venus and Moon auspicious Argala, Subhargala, is obstructed by Saturn, but the Rahu Ketu Argala is unobstructed. And in general, in Trimshamsa, the Argala of Rahu and Ketu on any planet is severe, because they are the ones who cause depletion of tissues. So, depletion of the functionality of the tissues also. So, Rahu and Ketu having Argala and Mercury is not so good.
That's why they're causing the nervous.
So, there is some nervous problem. Mercury having Argala from Rahu Ketu, Mercury having, Mercury being in the 8th house, shows some nervous problem. And of course, those Rahu and Ketu who have Argala on them are in a Vayurasi. So it's falling in place beautifully. So there is an affliction to Mercury and there is affliction to Vayu. So there is some nervous problem also. It's not just, it is physical also. There is a problem in the body. But then this is basically Trimshamsa shows subconscious problems manifesting physically. So anything shown in the Trimshamsa happens, finally it manifests physically, but the physical problem is coming because the communication that's happening inside has some subconscious problem. Any problem that we get into, physical problems, come because of some subconscious reasons. So this shows the subconscious reason, but also it manifests physically. Okay, so there is a problem. There is a problem. So here, who is the savior? From the point of view of the affliction in the Trimshamsa, who is the savior? Who can you propitiate for relief from this? Well, Mercury and Venus have a parivartana, and Mercury, because he is in the 8th house and all that, if you pray to Mercury, he can give relief. If you get blessings of Mercury, they can be released. And Mercury and Venus have a parivartana. Mm-hmm. So you can pray to Mercury and Venus. Parivartana is Lakshmi and Narayana. You can pray to Vishnu. And in the other chart that we saw, D24, the planet was Saturn. Again, Saturn can be Venkateshwara, he can just be Vishnu also. So, in both the cases, Saturn and Mercury are standing out. So, Vishnu, worship of Vishnu can be a very auspicious thing. It can save the person. And just for the sake of completeness, let's see what is the Rashi Narayana Dasarani. Now that is also an important parameter. How is the Rashi Narayana Dasa right now? Based on the Rashi Narayana Dasa, the Dasa running right now is that of Libra. How is Libra? Libra is basically Lagna. So all the sixth house, sixth Lord Jupiter affecting all these things that we observed earlier will be there. But the next Dasa is that of Scorpio. How is Scorpio Dasa? If you take Scorpio as Lagna, how are things? Well, Lagna Lord Mars is in the second house with Ketu affected by. He is in Gandhanta, Lagna Lord is in Gandhanta, and Jupiter is in the 8th house, Gurjandal Yoga is in the 8th house. But luckily, Jupiter is the 5th Lord. Even though he is in the 8th house, Jupiter is the 5th Lord, he is affecting Lagna Lord Mars and Ketu. Not so bad. Right? So it's a little better. How is Sagittarius Dasa? Lagna is afflicted by 12th Lord's Master Ketu. Right? Yeah. And Lagna Lord Jupiter has Gurjandal Yoga.
Moon is in second house.
That's not bad. But he is the 8th Lord. So only savior is the 10th Lord Mercury is in the 10th house. But Lagna is quite beaten down. So, and if you look at, for example, the Dasha Pravesha Chakra. In the Dasha Pravesha Chakra also Lagna Lord is in the sixth house, the Dusthana. Lagna Lord is in the Dusthana and sixth Lord is aspecting Lagna. So it doesn't look too good actually. So if you look at the next few dasas seem not so good. And if you look at the Rasi, Vimshottari Dasa, the regular Vimshottari Dasa, Mundasa is not so auspicious. Actually, Mundasa is better. But the next Dasa, Mars is quite bad. Mars 2012 to 2019, Mars is in Gandhanta. And next is Rahu. Rahu is the one who is giving Gurchandala Yoga with the sixth lord. Not so good. And Jupiter Dasa comes very late in life. And again, that's not a rosy Dasa. So basically, looking at the Vimshottari Dasa as well as Narayana Dasa, see, Narayana Dasa also we were looking, right? Sagittarius Dasa is not so good. If you take Ketugan as Lagna, how is Ketugan Dasa? Well, if you take Ketugan as Lagna, Lagna Lord Saturn is in the fifth house. That is, that's okay, that's better. But Jupiter and Rahu, Gurjanal Yoga happens in the sixth house. And let's look at the Dasa Pravesh Chakra. Mars and Ketu are in Lagna. And the sixth Lord Mercury, he is affected by Rahu again. Just like in the natal chart where sixth Lord is affected by Rahu, again sixth Lord is affected by Rahu. And Lagna has Mars and Ketu. So not so auspicious. So for a foreseeable future, bad Dasas are running based on Vimshottari as well as Narayana Dasa. So whatever we suggested, worship we suggested, it can only have little bit of impact, not really much impact. In some cases you can say if you do this and this, there will be a big impact. There can be, because you are on the edge basically of good and bad. Whereas here, you are not on the edge, you are actually well into the bad. So even with some propitiation, things will still be so-so. So unfortunately, I can't give much hope in this particular chart. And in the Mars Dasa, during 2012 to 2018, Sagittarius Dasa runs and at the same time Mars Dasa also runs, right, as per Vimshottari. So apart from Vishnu that we suggested earlier, if you do something for Mars, it can be Mars along with nodes can be Subrahmanya. So in 2012-2019 time frame, if they are doing heavy finance for Subrahmanya, Subrahmanya can give some relief. Okay. So lifelong some worship of Vishnu is needed, and in addition during 2012 to 2019 worship of Mars is needed. Worship of Subrahmanya.
Not so good planet in this chart.
No, he is not. He is in Gandhanta. You can propitiate bad ones. You don't wear ring of bad one. But propitiation, if you propitiate, you are basically some, let's say an evil person wants to come and kill you. You just pray to him, please spare me, please spare me, please spare me. Maybe after you say it 100 times, maybe he will spare you. So you can propitiate a good planet for you, good planet who is weak and not able to do give the results that he wants to give. You can propitiate so that he summons more in energy and gives the good results that he anyway wants to give, but unable to give. Whereas if bad planet is there for you, you propitiate and request, please don't beat me down so badly. Please reduce your intensity so that I can suffer less. So that is perfectly valid. And here, instead of strengthening some planet like Venus, because he doesn't have anything to do with Jupiter-Mars combination and he is enemy with them. So the Lagna Lord, even though he is reasonably well placed, he is helpless. So when your home owner cannot save the home from a gangster who is threatening you, you directly go to the gangster and request him. Or you make friends with a friend of gangster and ask him to help. So that is also possible. For example, Jupiter. Jupiter is the dispositor of Mars and he is a friend of Mars. And he himself is a bad planet here. Because he is a benefic planet, you may say that he will listen easier. So you can say, I will propitiate Jupiter and ask him to...
He is affected afflicted with
check Mars. Yeah, he is afflicted with Rahu. You can do that also, but my take is just worship Mars himself directly. He is a neutral planet in this chart. So, worshipping Mars, worshipping Subramanya, Mars with a Sarpagraha, Ketu, in a fiery sign, Sagittarius clearly shows Subramanya. So, worship Subramanya, Lord Subramanya. That is the best thing to do. But, then relief will come after 2012. So, based on all the factors we have seen, things look quite bad, and suggest him to do Subramanya, learn any Subramanya mantras and do them with the sankalpa that his or her son should improve, and then pray to Vishnu. Read Vishnu Sahasranama Stotram every Saturday and every events day. Okay? Who gives asthma?
It's a muscle lungs.
Yeah, it's in the lungs. It's an affliction of the lungs, right?
Chest, right.
And how? Where do you see chest from? How do you see the lungs, etc.? Which
house?
Third house in the natural zodiac as well as the given zodiac, the individual zodiac. In the natural zodiac, the third house has Jupiter-Rahu combination. And in the chart, third house has Mars in Kandanta, the Marka Mars in Kandanta. So there is an affliction to the third house as well as third lord. So some problem in the throat or in the lungs is quite possible. It's not really impossible. Right? Okay.
It came from the birth. How do we...
When the combination is so bad, when the affliction is so bad, it can happen at any age, including from birth.
So it doesn't have with the Mars dasa, right?
Pardon me?
Doesn't have a birth, and the birth, the Mars dasa is not running, so
yeah.
I'm just thought about it. If it affects from the birth, that dasa should, either Ketu dasa or Mars dasa should be at birth, right?
Not necessarily, because the combination is so bad, it can happen from birth itself. And this Mars, he's aspecting the Lagna Lord. The Mars is aspecting the Lagna Lord, and Jupiter is aspecting Lagna, the third Lord Jupiter. So the problem can happen since birth. And actually, if you want to look at the diseases, the best is Shashtamsa, right? And you look at Shashtamsa Paryayadasa. Instead of Narayanadasa Vimshottari, look at the Paryayadasas. Okay. Now you can see if there is a problem possible from birth. Right? What kind of problem you can see from Rashi chart? Mars and Ketu in the third house, or some problem of the lungs. But why is it triggered early in life? Let's see. What dasa is running here? Aquarius dasa is running at birth. And how is Aquarius? Well, it is the sixth house containing the sixth lord. And as we discussed many times before, sixth house having sixth lord or eighth house having eighth lord is not Harsha Yoga or Sarala Yoga and Shastamsa, or even Vipritha Raja Yoga, sixth lord, eighth lord being together in eighth. These are not really auspicious yogas in D6. They are bad yogas. So, sixth lord in the sixth house, Saturn, and the dasa, corresponding dasa is running right now. And of course, Saturn is a planet of diseases in general. He is the karaka of diseases. And also, he shows vayu, he shows breathing. And any Saturn affliction can show breathing problems. In addition, the physical organ that is afflicted is, from the Rashi chart, third house is very weak. So, putting everything together, there can be some problems relating to breathing and some weakness of the lungs. And how is Leo? Can Leo bring relief? Leo is coming in 2010. Can it bring relief? Not really. It's the 12th house. It's again another Dusthana. 12th house can even show hospitalization. So there is a chance of actually some serious problem and being hospitalized in that dasa. How is Pisces? Can there be relief in Pisces dasa? Pisces is Badrasthana. Right? Pisces is Badrasthana. Again, Badrasthana...
Badrasthana Lord is exalted.
Well, is the exaltation of Badrasthana Lord a good thing or bad thing?
It's not
good. So, things are actually quite bad till 2021. Virgo, how is that? 2021 is Virgo dasha. How is that? Yeah. It's the Lagna itself. So, Lagna itself and its Lord Mercury is in a friendly sign. So, that can bring some relief. After 2021, there can be some relief. And let's go back now. How is, what dasa is running? Rahu dasa. Vaishnava Vimshati, it is Rahu dasa, not so good. So, Paryaya dasa is showing some relief, but other thing doesn't really show it. And Kepigan dasa. Taking Kepigan as Lagna, we saw that this chart itself, Rasi chart, Natal Rasi chart looks okay from Kepigan, but the dasa Pravesh Chakra looks bad. We saw earlier. So, overall, if there is some good factor here, there are two or three other bad factors which are compensating. So there is no onset of a good period universally based on all the factors that we have access to. Which means, overall, this person is not lucky with respect to health, with respect to intelligence, learning, etc. So there is some problem or the other. So all we can say is, pray to Vishnu, pray to Kartikeya, Subrahmanya, and be prepared for the worst. And hopefully, if your remedy is basically cross a certain threshold, as you do, the thing is, serious problems require serious remedies. If you just do 10 minutes, 15 minutes, nothing will happen.
Isn't
so, if you are.
And karmic debt? How do we see this? Because the child is born, right?
Right. What is the dasa that shows the root cause of whatever is happening right now? Mola dasa, right? What is the mola dasa running at birth? Sun dasa is running at birth, right? Is sun, and to judge the mola dasa, if you know Shashtamsa accurately, you can use Shashtamsa. If you don't, then forget it. But if you know the Shashtamsa accurately, you can use it. And if you can't use Shashtamsa, if you don't know for sure what the lagna in Shashtamsa is, at least you can see what amsa the planet is in. Sun is in Kalna Samsa. Kalna Sam is destruction of strife. Actually, it's a good Samsa. So, and his Moladasa is running at birth. So, actually, it should be good. So, in Samsa, Sun should be quite bad. Unfortunately, I'm not confident what the Samsa Lagna is. If it is Pisces, Sun would be in the 8th house. If it is Capricorn, Sun would be the 8th lord. But with this Lagna, Sun is not so bad. But he is in Bhaskasthana. So, either way, with all the three, there is some problem with Sun. Moreover, in the Rashi Dasha, if you take, from Lagna, he is in 11th house, but more importantly, he is Badhaka Lord in Badhakasthana. So, Badhaka Lord's Mola Dasha is running. And from Moon or Arvana Lagna, he is the 8th Lord. So, there is some problem. So, this is one thing. This is what Mola Dasha is what shows the root cause of what is happening. And also, are there any sapas? You can see if there are any sapas, the sapas can actually show the problem. Like you said, for some big suffering, there can be some sapas. Are there any sapas in this chart? Do you see?
We only see Rashi chart.
Right? Yeah, Rashi chart. Are there any sapas?
It has to be malefic.
Well, look at Jupiter. He is with Rahu and Mars is aspecting him. Two malefics having association of Jupiter. What is that, a sapa? Yeah, it's a Brahmana sapa. So there is a Brahmana sapa yoga from the previous life. Are there any other things? Fourth house, fourth lord, moon, no. Ninth house has moon, Rahu and Mars aspecting it. So let's look at ninth lord. He is ninth lord. Aspected by malefic? Not really. Malefic is not affected. So, the main sapa in the chart, pardon me?
But they are aspected by Rahu. But Venus has the two malefics.
Right? Venus has two malefics aspecting. But Venus is Lagna Lord. I mean, you need the either fourth lord, fourth house, moon, or ninth lord, ninth house, sun, etc. So, these are the things. So, there aren't any serious sapas. There are some sapas, but nothing serious. But Jupiter, Brahmana Sapa is a serious Sapa. Rahu is reasonably close to Jupiter and Mars is in Gandanta. So, Brahmana Sapa is a very serious Sapa in this chart. So, apart from the remedies that we suggested, Kartikeya and Vishnu, the remedy for Brahmana Sapa can be done. And by the way, gosh, this is what I suspected. That's why I opened this longitude window. Rahu is Atmakaraka. When Atmakaraka is involved in a sapa, it is quite bad. The soul basically is involved in it. So it's a very serious tapa.
That is why we are seeing all those every aspect.
Right. The health wise is really, really bad. So, Brahmana tapa, there are certain remedies that are given in Brihat Parasarvara Shastram. So the remedies given in BPHS for Brahmana tapa yoga dosha should be followed and give liberally, generously. Donate cows, donate gold, donate land, etc. to a Brahmin. Not just any Brahmin. The problem is, when you say donate to a Brahmin, not everybody who is born as a Brahmin and who goes by as a Brahmin is really a Brahmin. Brahmana is somebody who is not that interested in money, that interested in power and authority over other people, and not that interested in physical pleasures. Brahmana is somebody who is interested in knowledge, learning, spiritual progress. That alone is a Brahmana. If somebody wants to control other people, he is a Kshatriya. If somebody wants to make a lot of money, he is a Vaishya. If somebody wants physical pleasures, he is a Shudra. So here, when you say donate things to a Brahmin, find somebody who is worthy, who is really spiritual, who is not into money and authority, who is basically interested only in knowledge. Find a good Brahmin like that, and donate. Help the Brahmin a lot. That will put them in good stead. So take care of the Brahmana tapa dosha, do remedies for it, given in BPHS. And do Gandhanda Santa Dosha for Mars if it wasn't already done. In case they haven't done it before, because he was born here, maybe they didn't, or maybe nobody told them there is a Gandhanda Santa Dosha. So do the Santi for that and do the other prayers, Kartikeya and Vishnu. Hopefully there will be some improvement. There may not be full cure and he may not be perfect, but at least he may be in the right environment and making enough progress and having a decent life.
Is this the Shapas throughout the life or?
Usually Shapas are throughout the life. Okay, so with that, all the best to this child. Unfortunately, we can't help more. With that, I will end for today. Om Shanti. There is one more thing. I'm sorry. I'm really sorry. I suspected that there is something else in the chart. That is why I opened this Mruchubhaga while trying to close the class. I was suspecting that there may be a Mruchubhaga planet. And actually, Mars, who's in Gandhanta, who is the Maraka, who is affected by Ketu, is also in the Mruchubhaga. So Mars is quite bad. So Kartikeya worship is very, very important. Apart from the Brahmana tapa, etc., Kartikeya worship is very important. Mars is really, really terrible planet. Oh, you go to the basics tab and then key info tab, which is the default, and there you normally see longitude, right? In that window, click the pop-up menu and it says distances from Mruchubhaga and Pashkarabhaga. So here if you click on that, you will see if any planet is in Mruchubhaga. Mm-hmm. There is a degree, a trimshamsa, which is called Mruchubhaga for each planet. It varies from sign to sign. It is basically a function of the planet as well as sign. For Mars, in Sagittarius it is one particular degree. In Leo it is another degree. In Scorpio it is another degree, and so on. So Mars here is in Mruchubhaga. It is having a single planet in Mruchubhaga is quite bad. That planet can really give problems. So now given this,
in what sense?
Physical problem, death-like problem. It's not necessarily death always, but death-like suffering. So the Mars Dasha, which is going to come soon in 2012, is quite serious. 2012 to 2019 is very bad. So all the remedies have to start right now. Even if they are not seeing any results, don't really be disappointed, don't be disheartened. Keep doing it, because otherwise after 2012 there can be a very serious setback in life, which can be, if not averted, which can be reduced in tone by doing prayers. So unfortunately, with that negative prognosis and advice, I will end for today. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Gana पतिं हवामहे कविं कवीनामुपमश्रवस्तमम् ज्येष्ठराजं ब्रह्मणां ब्रह्मणस्पत आनः शृण्वन्नूतिभिः सीदसादनम् ॐ श्रीमहागणाधिपतये नमः। ॐ वृषभं शर्षणीनां विश्वरूपमदाभ्यं बृहस्पतिं वरेण्यम् ॐ तद्विष्णोः परमं पदं सदा पश्यन्ति सूरयः दिविवचक्षुराततम् ॐ श्लीं ह्रीं ज्योतिर्ब्राह्माय नमः। से हरे राम कृष्ण थ्री टाइम्स। ओम हरे राम कृष्ण हरे राम कृष्ण हरे राम कृष्ण। Welcome back. We will do the 23rd chapter, Jaya Bhava Phalajjhaya, effects of the 12th house. Athaha Jaya Bhavasya Kathayami Phalam Dvija Yaye Se Subha Samyukte Svabhe Svochagate Piva Yaye Je Subha Samyukte Shubha Karje Vyayastada Chandro Vyayadipo Dharma Labha Mandre Samsthedaha उच्चे स्वर्क्षे निजांसे वा लाभ धर्मात्मजांसके दिव्यागारादि पर्यंको दिव्य गंधैक भोगवान् पराज्यरमणो दिव्य वस्त्रमाल्यादि भूषणः पराज्य वित्त संयुतो विघ्नो दिनानि नैति प्रभु। अथाह व्यय भावस्य कथयामि फलं द्विजा। ओ ब्राह्मिन, नाउ आई एम गोइंग टू से द रिजल्ट्स ऑफ द 12th हाउस। Jaya Bhava literally means the Bhava of loss. Also, it means the 12th house. Yayeshe Subha Samyukte Svabhe Svochagate Piva. Yayeshe means if the 12th Lord Subha Samyukte is with functional benefits, the 12th Lord is with functional benefits, Svabhe means in own house, Svochagate Piva. Or in own exaltation sign. So if the 12th Lord is either with benefits, functional benefits, or in exaltation sign, or in own sign, then what? The next line will give the results of it. Yayecha Shubha Samyukte, and also, in addition, Yayecha Shubha Samyukte, benefits in the 12th house. And the word Shubha is usually used for functional benefits, whereas Somya is used for natural benefits. So, most likely this is functional benefit. So, 12th Lord has to be with functional benefits or exalted or own sign, and 12th house should have benefits, functional benefits in it. Shubhakarye vyayastada. Then, Shubhakarye vyayaha. Tada means then, Shubhakarye vyayaha. Vyaya are actually not the, earlier I said loss. Vyaya doesn't necessarily mean loss. Vyaya means an expenditure. Some money leaving you. Maybe with your own accord, or it may be unexpected. If it is unexpected, it is a loss. If you knew it, you were in control of it, it's an expense. And some expenses are good expenses, and some expenses are foolish expenses. And here he is saying, in this particular case, the 12th is well endowed, and the 12th Lord is also strong and auspicious, then the expenses will be on auspicious matters. Right. If the 12th is also good. 12th Lord has to be either exalted or own sign or with a benefit. Functional benefit. So there are three conditions, one of them. And 12th also has some functional benefit in it. That's 12th house. So basically both the house and the Lord are basically supported by good planets, then that means there are good expenses. Chandro vyayadhipo dharma labha mantresu samsthitah. Chandro dharmadhipo. Chandro vyayadhipo means moon is the 12th lord. Dharma labha mantresu samsthitah. And he is in the dharma labha mantras. What is dharmasthana? 9th. What is labha? 11th. What is mantra? 5th. So he is in 9th or 11th or 5th. 5th, 9th and 11th. Moon. Moon happens to be the 12th lord. And he is in basically either 5th or 9th or 11th. Svokshe svarkshe nijam seva labha dharmatma jansake. Svokshe svarkshe nijam seva. Means svokshe. Exaltation sign, swarkshe, own sign, nijam seva, means own amsha. He is either exalted or in own sign or at least in own amsha. Which amsha? Probably nava amsha. Nothing is mentioned. Swarkshe, swarkshe, nijam seva, labha dharmatma jamsake. Labha dharmatma jamsake. Labha means gain. Dharma means, wait one second. No. Dharmatmaja. Let's see how he translates. One will own beautiful houses and beds and be enrolled with superior central articles and feathers. If moon happens to be the 12th lord and be exalted in one sign by Navamsa, exalted or be in one sign and Navamsa, or in the 11th, 9th and 5th in Rasi Navamsa. He actually skipped that. You know, actually he didn't skip, he didn't interpret, okay. Labha means, again 11, Dharma means, again 9, Atmaja means, Sun, one who is born from the Self. So again he is mentioning the same thing, but now he is saying Amsake. Earlier he said Dharma Labha Mantresu Samsthitah. He is in the 5th, 9th or 11th. Here he is saying he is in the 5th or 9th or 11th in Amsha. Yeah. So he is in the 5th house or 9th house or 11th house in either Rashi or Navamsa. Or he is in one sign in either Rashi or Navamsa. Or he is exalted. Then, what is the result then? Of course, before all this, he has to be the 12th lord. So, this is specifically for Leo Lagna people. Leo. Right. Now, Divyagaradi Paryanko, Divya Gandhaika Bhagavan. Divyagara means, Divya means divine. Agara means residence. So, divine houses. He basically interpreted as beautiful houses, of course. Yeah. So, especially it's a good combination. Divya Gandhaika Bhagavan means Divya, again, divine or great, Gandhaika Bhagavan, divine perfumes, etc. he enjoys. So, basically he spends on material, not merely divine, but what do you mean? Yeah. He, for divine experience in the material plane, he spends a lot of money. Bottom line is, moon is the planet of all these things. Moon is the planet of mind. Moon is the planet of overall enjoyment. So, if moon is associated with the 12th house and if he is really strong, the person will spend on all these things like being in a nice house, nice ambience in the house, and nice perfumes, etc., nice clothes. So on all these things the person will spend a lot of time. Bottom line is 12 planets associated with the 12th house, especially the 12th lord, they show expenses. And depending on who they associate with, in what state they are, they show big expenses or small expenses. And depending on their nature, they may show expenses on different causes. Because this moon is talking about a house, a perfume, etc. All these luxuries. Whereas if he is Mars, maybe on something else, maybe on some high-tech thing, or if it is Jupiter, it may be on religious causes, religious expenses, like that basically. You can look at the nature of the planet associated with the 12th house, and then say this kind of expense is possible. If the planet is strong, the expense will be big. And if the planet is auspicious, the expense will be auspicious. You have Sagittarius Lagna, 12th Lord is Mars. Who is in the 12th house?
Moon. Moon in 12th house and 12th Lord in Virgo.
Yeah?
So that gives me expenses all the time on many electrical, electronic gadgets.
Yeah, it could.
Naturally, it shows that because any other things I directly go and just buy them out.
Right. See, the thing is, Moon is in the 12th house. Is he a benefic or malefic? He's a neutral planet. He's a neutral planet for this chart. Right? What? Okay. The 3rd, 6th and 11th lords are functional malefic, and the lords of 5th, 9th, they are benefic. So all the standard rules, if you refresh, you will see that for Sagittarius Lagna, Moon is a functionally neutral planet. So 12th house is not really hammered by a malefic or something. It's a neutral planet. Even naturally, he is a benefic. So functionally he is neutral, and naturally he is a benefic, and he is in the 12th house. Okay. Now, the 12th lord who shows the expenses, who shows the intelligence applied to expense, what kind of decisions are made relating to expenses, expenditure. So that Mars, he is in a quadrant. Even though he is not in own sign or exaltation sign, he is in a quadrant. So which is a good placement. And he is in a Mercury sign. Mercury sign is a good placement for Mars. And he is with Mercury, who is exalted. So because Mars is in a quadrant with his dispositor exalted along with him, he is basically strong. So it can show a lot of expenses, good expenses, etc. Relating to perhaps Martian areas.
Engineering,
etc. Like that. Now,
so in summary, you say moon being a particular lord, it is in 5, 9, 11 houses, or in exalted, or in
sign. Right. Now, one sign or 5th, 9th, and 11th can also be?
In Navamsa.
Yes, in Navamsa also.
Then the expenses are automatic.
Then the expenses will be, he will spend money and acquire nice houses, nice perfumes, nice. Luxurious living, basically. The living will be luxurious. Okay. Rajya Ravano Divya Vastra Malyada Bhushana Rajya Vittasam Yukto Vignodina. Something is wrong. The last line is Chandas is broken. Dinani Naiti Prabhu is fine. Dinani Naiti Prabhu is eight akshar. Rajya Vitta Samyukto Vigno, I think, is probably not there. Or if Vigno is there, something else is not there. Anyway, bottom line is there isn't anything interesting here. All it's saying is he will have great, nice clothes, nice ornaments, nice. He is basically, he is like a king, and he has all nice luxuries surrounding him. That's basically what he's saying. But there is some word, extra word there. There are two extra letters in the last line. So something is amiss. But we don't really have to solve the mystery because it doesn't really matter. This is just a result. There is no formula for the yoga, which is already done. The next is Yevam Swachatru Nicham Seshtamanse Vashtame Ripo Sankthira Kurute Jatam Kanta Sukha Vivarjitam Vyadhikya Pariklantam Divya Bhoga Nirakrutam Sahi Kendra Trikonastaha Swastriyalam Kruta Swayam. Okay. Yevam Swachatru Nicham Seshtamanse Vashtame Ripo Yevam like this. Swasyatru Nichamse Swasyatru Nichamse Ashtamamse Atva Ashtame Ripo. Okay. So now he is giving a more, he is giving negative combinations. He is saying Swasatru Nichamse. Swasatru means an own enemy. That means somebody who is an enemy of that planet. Satru Nichamse. Nichamse means, so Swasatru Nichamse, Amsa is basically applied to both, Swasatru Amsa and Nichamsa. So Swasatru Amsa means an enemy's Navamsa. If the planet is in an enemy's Navamsa, or Ashtamamse. Ashtamamse means eighth Amsa. So in the eighth house, in the eighth house, or in an enemy sign, in the Navamsa. Va Ashtame Ripo. Or in the sixth or eighth. So the 12th lord is either in the sixth house or in the eighth house, or in an enemy's Navamsa, or in a debilitation Navamsa. Okay? If that is the case, one will, the result is samsidah kurte jatam samsidah. If the 12th lord is like that, kurte jatam, he does, he makes the born person kanta sukha vivarjitam. Kanta sukha vivarjitam means devoid of, vivarjitam means left by, kanta sukha means the happiness of a spouse. So the person will not have the spouse of happiness of a spouse if 12th lord is in the 6th house or 8th house, 12th lord is in the 6th house or 8th house, or in a debilitated Navamsa, or in an enemy's Navamsa. So basically if the 12th lord is badly placed, it is not good for, it's not good for marital pressure. So he is actually saying the 12th house, apart from expenses, it also shows marriage.
व्ययाधिक्य परिक्लांतम् दिव्यभोग निराकृतम् सहिकेन्द्र त्रिकोणस्थः स्वस्त्रियालंकृतः स्वयं. व्ययाधिक्य परिक्लांतम्
means व्ययाधिक्य, too many expenses, परिक्लांतम् troubled by them, he is surrounded and troubled by too many expenses. दिव्यभोग निराकृतम्, निराकृतम् means rejected by, दिव्यभोग means divine pleasures. So great luxuries, etc., they don't come to that person. So if the 12th lord is debilitated in Navamsa, or in the 8th house, etc., in the Navamsa, or 6th or 8th in the Rashi, then he will not have any luxuries, and he will have too many expenses that will be difficult to handle. But if he is in a Kendra or Trikona, instead of 6th or 8th, the 12th lord is in a Kendra or Trikona, Swastriyalankrita Swayam. Then he is, Alankrita means decorated. Swastriya means own wife, own spouse. Decorated by own spouse. Decorated means accompanied by own spouse. He has a nice spouse basically. Instead of being in the 6th or 8th, etc., or debilitated in Navamsa, etc., if the 12th lord is in a Kendra or Kona, in a quadrant or a triangle, like in your case. In your case, the 12th lord is in a Kendra. So, he doesn't specifically say, so either. In your case, he is in quadrant in both. So, you are basically, you don't have all these bad things. You are not rejected by luxuries. You will have some luxuries, and you will have a spouse. You will have the happiness of a spouse. Right. So, that is what this verse means. And the next verse is, यथा लग्नात् फलं चैतद् आत्मा आत्मनः परिकीर्तितम्. यथा लग्नात् फलं चैतद् आत्मनः परिकीर्तितम् एवं भ्रात्रादि भावेषु तत्तत् सर्वं विचारयेत्. दिस् इस् गुड्. यथा लग्नात् फलं चैतद्, जस्ट् एज़् द रिजल्ट्स् हैव बीन् सेट् फ्रॉम् लग्ना फॉर सेल्फ, जस्ट् लाइक् दैट, जस्ट् एज़् दे आर् एक्स्प्लेन्ड् एवं लाइक् दिस् भ्रात्रादि भावेषु,
from the houses of the brother, etc., that means third house, etc., tatsa sarvam vicharayet. You can do the analysis also. What he is saying is, instead of looking at the 12th lord, you can look at the 2nd lord. Take the 3rd house as lagna and see how the 12th lord, how the 2nd lord is. And then say, who he is in one house or he is exalted different sign, so there are expenses for brother, like that. So, for brother. To see the expenses of brother. Similarly, to see the expenses of father, 9th house as reference. Then 8th house will show father's expenses. So he is saying, basically, you can take any bhava as the lagna and see the expenses of person shown by that bhava.
दृश्य चक्रार्थगाः हेताः प्रत्यक्ष फलदायकाः अदृश्यार्थगताः हेताः परोक्षे फलदास्मृताः. दृश्य चक्रार्थगाः,
दृश्य मीन्स सीएबल, विजिबल, बेसिकली विजिबल. सो चक्रा मीन्स साइकिल, जोड़िया. अर्धा मीन्स हाफ. गा मीन्स गॉन इनटू. सो दोज हु हैव गॉन इनटू द visible half of the zodiac, visible half of the zodiac and cycle, kheta, those planets, pratyaksha phaladayaka, they give results that are easy to see, results that are obvious. Adrishyardhagata, invisible half planets, planets which have gone into invisible half, adrishyardhagata kheta, parokshe phaladasmata, they give results in paroksha, means it's not very obvious. They give inobvious results. So he's saying, so this is not just for the 12th house, this one and the previous one, taking the 3rd house, etc. as lagna, these are generic guidelines for all houses so far. So most of the results given by planets, what is the visible half? What is the invisible half?
It's the reverse.
From 7th house to lagna. Yeah. That's the visible half. Because, see, lagna is, let's say, Scorpio 10 degrees, okay? That is exactly on the east. Now, the points after that haven't risen yet. So, they are actually below horizon. So as lagna progresses, as earth rotates, now 10 degrees Scorpio is on the east. A little later, 20 degrees Scorpio will be on the east and 10 degrees will have risen. Instead of being on the exact east, it will be risen. So the thing is, all the points from lagna till the 7th house, 180 degrees from lagna. So that 180 degree will be under the horizon, under the eastern horizon until under the western horizon, under. Whereas, if you look at the 180 degree point from lagna, it is exactly on the western horizon. And the point after that is little above the western horizon. The point above is even little further. So, 180 degrees from lagna to lagna, that is the visible half. So, the planets in that half, they give results in a very obvious way. Their results will be very, other results will be very subtle. Results will be very obvious. So this is actually a very useful hint in general. It is actually good to have good Rajogas in the visible half, like you. Yeah, the 10th lord and 5th lord together in the 10th house, if you end Mars, it's in the visible half. Yeah, you have to. This is not based on science, this is based on the half of the zodiac. So you have to look at, in his case, lagna is at 24 degree 22 minutes Sagittarius. So 24 degree 21 22 minutes Gemini till 24 degree 21 minutes Sagittarius. That is the visible half for Sheshu. Again, if you want to see brother, his visible half will be different.
Third house.
So 24 degree 22 minutes in Aquarius is the 3rd house. So from there take the 180 degree point. From there, so 24 degree, approximately 24 degree Leo, till 24 degree Aquarius. That is the visible half. Planets in that half, they give more visible results to the younger brother.
Whether it's positive or negative.
Whether it's positive or negative. Visible doesn't mean positive. Visible only means it's more obvious. More easily seen. The next verse is Jayasthana Gato. Yes, Gatoho, it says, the Visarga is wrong. Jayasthana Gato Rahu. Oh, you know, Rahur. Oh, okay. Gato, not Gatoho. Vyasthana Gato Rahur Bhaumar Ki Ravi Samyutaha Tadise Pyarka Samyukte Narake Patanam Bhaveto. Vyasthana Gato Rahu. Means Rahu is in the 12th house. Rahu has gone into the Jayabhava. Bhaumar ki ravi samyutaha. Bhauma, Mars, Bhumi sun, Mars. Arki means Arkas sun. Arka is sun. Arkas, Arki means Arkas sun. Sun, sun, Saturn. Ravi means sun. Samyutaha means accompanied by. So if Rahu is in the 12th house, accompanied by either Mars or Saturn or sun. Basically functional, natural male fix. Sun, Mars, Saturn. Tadise pyarka samyukte. And it's locked also. Tadisepi arka samyukte. And it's locked is also with sun. Okay? So 12th lord is with sun and 12th contains Rahu with either sun or Mars or Saturn. So basically both 12th and 12th lord, both 12th and 12th lord are basically containing male fix, especially Rahu. Particular key is Rahu in the 12th. Then what is the reason? Sun is also considered male fix here. Then what is the reason? Narake patanam bhavet. The person will fall into hell. So basically, again, see, this is the beauty with Parashara. Don't take each verse as just one, I mean, this is the result. For example, earlier he said, if the 12th lord is with benefic, exalted, our own sign, or in own Navamsa, then Shubhakarya, there will be epic expenses on Shubhakarya. What if he is with male fix, in debilitated Navamsa, like that basically, what some good results, some bad results he has given. You can basically take the opposite and you can deduce other results. But bottom line is, first he said, the expenses can be saved. Second he said, in the next set of verses, he suggested that spouse and happiness from spouse can also be seen. Not just expenses on houses, perfumes, luxuries, etc. But even expenses on wife, not expenses, sorry. Even happiness of spouse can be seen from this house. And happiness of spouse, from spouse, first spouse, by spouse. Exactly. It's mutual. Not none. So he is basically saying that. Now he is saying, now he is giving a different kind of result. Going to hell from the 12th house. So what this means is, 12th house is also the house of where you go. Where you go after death. This is your gati, final gati. 4th house is the basic gati. While you are alive, the basic direction of, okay, I want to go there. I want to be spiritual. I want to see. I want to make sounds. I want to achieve sounds or something. Or I want to get moksha. I want to do dharma. I want to construct a temple. I want to see a god. I want to see a goddess. Like that, you have some direction in your spiritual pursuit. That is 4th house. That is the beginning. 8th house is all the sadhana you are doing. And 12th house is the culmination. So, the place where you go to after your death, whether you go to tapoloka or satyaloka or jnanaloka or bhurloka, suvarloka or some naraka. Pardon me? Here he is only talking about Rashi. Right. But the thing is, the bottom line is, the planet in the 12th house and the 12th lord, they show the place you go to. But more than the 12th lord, 12th house is important, and affliction of rank male fix, including Rahu, is very important. Okay? And similarly, if you have, instead of Rahu, suppose you have Jupiter or Ketu in the 12th house with some benefits, with natural benefits. And let's say Ketu or Jupiter with some other natural benefits, and the 12th lord is also with benefits, then you can say
the person will have good gati. The person will go to higher loka, like that basically. So you can complete what Parashara says. He uses one verse, either in a positive way or negative way, to throw one more topic into this house, discussion on this house. So gati after death. Planets in the 12th house, and also 12th lord is important, because he said 12th lord also should be his son, he said. He only said son, but we can say all of them. It is logical to say. So let's say 12th house has Saturn with Rahu, and let's say 12th lord is with Mars. Probably that's sufficient to give a bad gati. Whose case? It's not 12th house. No. It's not about Rahu with Sun. It's about in the 12th house. Yeah, in the 12th house. So, if you are taking the 10th house as Lagna, then, but 10th house doesn't show any person. So, there is no point. See what I'm saying? You could actually show somebody. It could show 6th house shows. 6th house is the house of maternal uncle or enemy. And the fifth from there is the house of children of maternal uncle, Anku's children. So, 10th house does show Anku's children. So, Mercury and Mars in Virgo. Taking that as Lagna, the 12th has Rahu with Sun, and the 12th lord is also with male fifth, Rahu. So, some bad gati is possible, just based on this verse, some bad gati is possible for some child of the maternal uncle. Like that, you can basically look for a third house, ninth house, all the houses. But not for you. And even that, you have to be careful. I mean, Rahu is bad, but the thing is Rahu? How strong is he? There are so many other things to look at. But general guideline is this. Right. Yeah, here basically just You look at the Rashi, you just know one brother, you just get for all the brothers together. So this is a generic reading for most of the brothers, not any specific brother, but right, younger brothers. But if you want to be specific about each younger brother, you can go to Saptamsa and do the counting that we do, and when you in D3, when you take the Lagna corresponding to a particular brother, if you see that Rahu is in the 12th house with Mars and 12th lord is with Saturn, for example, you can say you will go to hell. The thing is, it's not a good thing to say. Whether he will really go to hell or not, for saying it, you will actually go to hell while you are there. The next verse is Vayasthanakate Saumye Tadise Socharachige शुभयुक्ते शुभयदृष्टे मोक्षस्यान्नत् नात्र संशयः. Is there a light? We have a light on. Okay. Yasthanagate Saumye means there are two interpretations. Saumya literally means Mercury, Soma's son. The other interpretation is somebody who is like Suma, like a flower. So basically a natural benefit. So it could mean a natural benefit or it could mean Mercury. Probably this means natural benefit. There is no need to actually say Mercury specifically, given the result here. So this is probably a natural benefit. So natural benefit in the 12th house, Tadise Swachcha Rashike, and the lord of the 12th house is an exaltation sign. Shubhayukte Shubhair Drushte, aspected by functional benefit or occupied by functional, conjoined by functional benefit. Moksha Sya Natra Samsayaha, then moksha there is no doubt. Well, this is actually a little extreme, because he did say for moksha, he did say things based on Navamsa earlier, based on the 12th house from the Atmakaraka in Navamsa, etc. So this is a little bit of stretch, but the thing is,
this is good for spiritual progress and going to a higher, making progress, going to a higher loka than where you came from in this current life. So the condition is the 12th should have a natural benefit and the 12th law should be exalted and occupy, conjoined or aspected by a benefit, a functional benefit. That's it. So 12th law in exaltation, a functional benefit associates with him by aspect or conjunction, and 12th has a functional natural benefit. See, for example, in your case, Sthanagate Saumye, the natural benefit is in the 12th house. Even though it is not that benefit, he is a kind. That's fine, but he is a natural benefic. Tadihe Socharasge. His lord is not in a exaltation sign, but he is in a quadrant with a natural benefic. So even though he is not exalted, he is with an exalted sign. So partially the thing is there. So you will get partial moksha. But this is good. Basically, 12th house is 45 based on these guidelines. But the thing is, if you really ask me, if you are looking at moksha, Rashi is not that important. Navamsa is more important. And Lagna is not that important. Atmagarga is more important. So if you ask me, apply whatever Parasa said here to the Navamsa. See, for example, your son is the Atmagarga. Oh, you have Lagna in 12th. Okay. So take him as the, take the, see here in your chart, Sun in Sagittarius is the Lagna, so Scorpio is the, Scorpio Lord is Mars, he is in a trine, he is with a natural benefic, he is with a natural benefic and Jupiter is aspecting him another natural benefic, so he is associated with natural benefic, even though he is not exalted, he is in a friendly sign in a trine, right, and the 12th is empty, there are no benefics or malefics aspecting it, so overall, this is good, pardon me? Yeah, he has Rashi Shruti, right? So, overall it is good basically. So like that. Actually one interesting thing I want to say about this particular chart is, see, data is 1961, September 16, 2:22 PM, Secunderabad, India. See, if you take the 12th lord from Atmakaraka, he is the key to moksha. He is the key to overcoming yourself, the emancipation of the soul. Where is he from Atmakaraka? He is in the 9th house. And what is the 9th house? It is the house of Dharma. So the thing is, we talk about this Dharma Devata, Pavana Devata, all this, right? So the thing is, between the moksha, Ishta Devata and Dharma Devata, there is a link. The planet who shows the Ishta is actually in the Dharmasthana from Atmakaraka. So the thing is, such people, they just follow their what seems as natural dharma. Then basically moksha is automatically taken care of. For many people, you follow your dharma, there is only the beginning of the process of emancipation. Whereas some people, you just do your dharma, certain duties you have, certain things to take care of. You just take care of them, other things are already taken care of for you. Because detachment, moksha comes from detachment. Not from working or doing things or following your dharma. Dharma, artha, kama, moksha are four different things. But the thing is, because there is a link between moksha and dharmasthanas here, by following your dharma, you become closer to your moksha. So that is a nice thing with this Navamsa. Now the next line, next verse is, Yaye se papa samyukte, yaye papa samanvite, पापग्रहेण संदृष्टे देश देशात् देशांतरं गतः ययेशे पाप संयुक्ते ययेशे पाप संयुक्ते means the 12th lord is with papa samyukta means with a functional malefic. The 12th lord is with a functional malefic. Yaye papa samanvite and the 12th is with functional malefic. Papagraheena sandrushte. Papagraheena sandrushte. Are aspected by a functional malefic. Deshaat deshantaram gataha. So if the 12th is conjoined by a malefic, the 12th lord is either conjoined or aspected by a malefic, the person goes from one country to another country. He will be wandering from country to country. He will not have a stable place to live. Because 12th house is the house of displacement from one place to another place. So if 12th has such negative indication, the person will not settle down in one place. He will go from India to US, US to UK, UK to Saudi Arabia, like that basically he will be going around. The next verse is, Yayeshe Shubharashisthe Vyarukshe Shubhasamjute Shubhagrahena Samdrushte Swadesha Sancharo Bhavet Yayeshe Shubharashisthe. The 12th Lord is in a benefic sign. What is a benefic sign? A sign worn by Moon, Mercury, Venus or Jupiter. So the 12th Lord has to be in a sign worn by Mercury, Jupiter, Venus or Moon. Yaye Papa Samanvite. Sorry. Vyese Subrahiste Vyarkshe Subhasamjite. And the 12th house has a benefic planet. The 12th house has a benefic planet. And the 12th Lord is in a benefic sign. Shubhagrahena Sandrushte. And the 12th house is aspected by Shubhagraha, a benefic planet. Swadesha Sancharo Bhavet. Then the person will leave the foreign, leave the own country. So he will leave his own country, but the previous verse says he will be wandering from country to country. Here it says Swadesha Sancharo Bhavet. There will be a movement from the native country. That means he won't be wandering, he will leave his country and settle in a nice place basically. He will have some stability, but away from his home. Actually, he translated as, one will move in his own country. I don't think that's right. Swadesha Sancharo Bhavet means, from the own country, there will be a travel. So the combination. It could mean. But the thing is, it shows leaving the birthplace, going somewhere else, and settling down there. But not instability, like in the previous verse. Previous verse was total inauspicious, all malefic. Here, the 12th Lord is in a benefic sign. And the 12th house has the benefic plan. So all benefics are there. But the thing is, because 12th is so nicely endowed, there will be a movement. But because all good planets, the movement will be stable. For example, in your case, 12th house has Moon, a benefic planet, a natural benefic. But actually the West is functional benefic, but Moon is functionally neutral. But being a natural benefic who is functionally neutral, he works as a benefic. So he is in the 12th house. And the 12th Lord, Mars, he is in a benefic sign. Virgo is a benefic sign and he is with a benefic. He is with Mercury, exalted Mercury. So this can show flourishing abroad. The next verse is Yaye Mandadi Samyukte Yaye Mandadi Samyukte Bhumujena Samanvite Shuhadrushter Na Samprapti Papa Mulad Dhanarjanam. Yaye Mandadi Samyukte Yaye Mandadi Samyukte means in the 12th house, Saturn, etc., Bhumijena Samanvite, accompanied by Mars. In the 12th house, Saturn, etc., are there along with Mars. So basically, Saturn, etc., means Saturn, Rahu, or Ketu, with Mars. So 12th house has Saturn, Rahu, or Ketu, with Mars. It's not clear, he only said Saturn, etc. Probably it could be Mars, Sun also. But my own feeling is it is Saturn, Rahu or Ketu with Mars. No Sun. Shubhadrushterna Samprapti. Shubhadrushterna Samprapti. Hello? Yesterday class was on Ravi. Yeah. Yeah, na urgent ananda. అదే తీసుకొచ్చి ఇంట్లో పెట్టేయండి, కొంచెమే పెట్టండి, ఓకే రుచికి ప్రసాదంలాగా పెట్టండి అంతే. థ్యాంక్స్ అండి. సో శుభగ్రహేణ శుభదృష్టేర్న సంప్రాప్తి మీన్స్ శుభదృష్టే న సంప్రాప్తి. That means, yes, there is no obtaining of benefic aspect. So, Saturn, Rahu or Ketu are with Mars in the 12th house and there is no benefic aspect. Then, Papamula Dhanarjanam. That means, the person will be earning money based on negative things, through sins. Could be gambling, could be anything. Could be a big racket, could be a big smuggling racket, could be a big prostitution racket, could be a big racket that sells girls to some foreign country. So many things are possible. There are infinite sins in this age. So bottom line is, these shady planets with Mars in the 12th house without any benefic aspect alleviating is something to be concerned about. It shows somebody who will be earning through bad means. Now, the hint here is, again, one more indication of the 12th house. Normally, getting money, how do we say? We say from the 11th house, 2nd house, all these houses. Here, he is basically looking at the 12th house and he is actually saying that 12th house also controls how money comes. And? Right, good. And? 2nd from 11th and 11th from 2nd. So from the 2nd house of assets and wealth, it is the 11th house of catalyst, of fructification. And from the 11th house of gains that you are receiving, it is the 2nd house of accumulation. So whatever gains that are coming, it basically shows the accumulation of the gain. 2nd house from 11th will show resources of profits. Resources from which the profits come from. And also being the 11th from 2nd, it shows what really gives a push to the wealth of the person. So the planets there, they show they have a control on the means through which you earn. They show what actually what means you use. So good planets there means you will use good means, bad planets means you will use bad means. And also the thing is, out of all the houses that have Argala on the 11th house and 2nd house, this is a common house which has Argala on both the houses. And in addition, this is the house of your final gati. So the way you used to accumulate your money, basically it controls what kind of gati you have. If there are malefics, you use malefic means and you get malefic gati. If there are benefits, you use benefic means and you get benefic gati. So it is an important house from that point of view. So he says a sinner basically in accumulating money. The last verse is Lagne se vyaya rashisthe vyaye se lagna samyute bhrugu putrena samyukte dharma moola dhana vyaya Lagne se vyaya rashisthe vyaye se lagna samyute Lagne se vyaya rashisthe means Lagna Lord is in 12th house. Yaye se Lagna samyute, that 12th Lord is in Lagna. So there is a parivartana between Lagna and 12th house. Bhruguputrena samyukte. Bhruguputrena samyukte. And the 12th Lord is with Venus. Dharma moola dhanavyayaha. Then the person will have expenses on dharmic matters for dharma. Okay. 12th Lord in Lagna, Lagna Lord in 12th. Lagna Lord in 12th and 12th Lord in Lagna with Venus. 12th Lord is the one who should be with Venus in Lagna. So 12th Lord and Venus are in Lagna. Then the person will spend money on religious causes. Well, Venus is a benefit planet and he is an important planet for dharma. Venus. So, do you think that if Jupiter instead of Venus is there also, the result can be said? In my belief, it can be said. my belief, when he said Bhruvutrena, he doesn't necessarily mean only Venus. This is just one guideline. Even Venus can give. So obviously, Jupiter can also give the expense on Dharma if this happens. Okay. So we will do the next chapter on Bhavesha Phalajjhaya. The lots of the various houses, if they are in various houses, there are specific results. Lagna lord in lagna, second house, third house, fourth house, and so on. Second lord in lagna, second house, third house, etc. There are results given by Parashara. We will see them in the next class. We will stop PPHS for now. But we have finished all the 12 chapters.
One question.
Yes. Well, let me put it this way. What may be considered Arjuna killing his guru, his brothers, everybody may be considered as a bad karma by some people. But if you see Arjuna's chart, you will not. I can tell you that the 12th house will not have a lot of malefic planets, etc., showing malefic karma. It will still show a benefic karma. But the thing is, there may be natural malefics there, like Mars, etc. There may be some combinations involving planets like Mars, but the thing is, you won't see a combination that shows bad karma. So, to say that somebody can actually do bad karma and get moksha, it is actually counterintuitive. Right. Let us treat them as exceptions rather than the rules. And even in their case, we don't know exactly what Ravana's chart is, for example. It's a good, very, very good question. But what exactly was Ravana's chart? What did the 12th house show? If the 12th house actually shows all malefic planets, it may not actually, he may not have a good gati. So probably the 12th house was very strong with benefic planets. But the karma being bad, maybe there are some bad planets in the 10th house. Because he did some good karma as well as bad karma. So other houses like 8th house, 10th house, etc., 9th house, there may be various combinations. But as far as the final gati is concerned, the possibility of moksha is concerned, the 12th house, from Lagna in the Rashi chart and from Atmakarka in Navamsa chart, they have to be fortified. If they are weak, there is no way he can have a higher gati. So even the so-called bad people, who actually had to do that bad karma as a part of the part of divine plan, there were houses in their chart that showed that bad karma, but the houses that show the gati, they probably have good combination, which is possible, right? And one thing is, when it comes to all these discussion about moksha, the gati, going to hell, going to heaven, going to different lokas, the thing is, you can see from that natal chart also, but like I said, more than Rashi, Navamsa is important and from Atmakarka is important. But if you want to analyze the Rashi chart from Lagna, the 12th house from Lagna in the Rashi chart, the Punya Chakra would be actually more relevant. The chakra, Punya Chakra is the chakra that is cast when a person leaves the body. So, if you accurately know the time when somebody passed away, which is not rare. So for several people, we do have the time when they actually pass away. If there is somebody around, they can actually note down the time. So if you know the time when somebody passed away, you can make a chart for that time. And you can, from that, you can try to guess the gati of the person after death. For example, what Krishna says in Gita is, the gati, the last second thought, when your body is finally leaving, the thought that comes to you at the last minute, that decides your next gati. That decides where you go, what desire you harbor. So, based on it, you may go to, let's say, Swarloka or Maharloka or some loka or some naraka, and also you may desire, you may suddenly, at the end of your life, when your whole life is basically goes by, in a split second, the whole life experience, you revise it. When you are leaving the body, you recollect the whole life experience, from this life as well as the previous life, you must think, oh my God, I wanted to do that, I couldn't do. For example, I wanted to construct a house in that my village, I couldn't. Like that, if there is any regret, or suppose you say, oh, that beautiful girl, I wanted to marry her, I could not marry her. Like that, if you have any thought, good or bad, or it could just be, I'm happy with everything I did, but the temple I wanted to construct, Shiva temple, I couldn't. Like that, any thought that comes to you, any thought, yes, it not can be, it will be trigger for next life. So, irrespective of what kind of sadhana you do, what level of control you get over your mind, irrespective of all that, even if your mind is never perturbed by anything, whether somebody praises you or criticizes you, you basically, your face may look different, but mentally you have the same impression, let us say. So like that you are, let's say, sthitadhir muni, like in Gita. Still, at the last minute, if there is a perturbation, and you basically hold on to a particular thought at the last second, when the mind is leaving, when the soul is leaving, that becomes the trigger of your next life. So that can be seen from the seventh house in the Punya Chakra. Actually, we'll try to do some Punya Chakras. This is something we haven't done before. We have only done Janma Chakras, not the Marana Chakras. So we'll try to do some Punya Chakra or Marana Chakras in the next class. I'll try to dig some samples, preferably ask some yogis, etc. We'll see. But the thing is, the basic rules are, the 12th house shows where you go, the place you go to after death. Immediately after death. Not immediately, because it comes in stages. For a while, the soul will linger around on earth for most people, and then it will go somewhere else. So the place where it will be guided finally, that place, that is seen from the 12th house. And the 7th house will show the desire, the last desire. And when it comes to the next life, the 7th house is the seed. The 7th house of the Punya Chakra is the seed of the next life. So it is possible that whatever yogas you see in the 7th house of the Punya Chakra, they may actually decide the next life chart. The next life chart may actually have similar yogas in the Lagna. Whatever is happening with respect to 7th house in the Punya Chakra, similar things may actually happen in the next life Jama Chakra. There is no proof, absolutely. I'm just saying whatever. But right, there is no proof. But the thing is, if you know, okay. Anyway, sure. I want to leave it at this too. We'll do Punya Chakras later. But the thing is, the 12th house in the Punya Chakra is more important than in the Janma Chakra. Because in the Janma Chakra, the 12th house not only shows the gati, the final gati, but it also shows so many things. So many things are shown by the 12th house. Whereas, if you take the Punya Chakra, the chart of leaving the body, it only shows one thing basically. The 12th house there is only your final gati, where you are going. So it is actually far more conclusive. Right? So all the rules that we have learnt now, they can be applied to Punya Chakra as far as gati, next gati is concerned. Okay.
So, we can figure out what is the 12th on what the
No, you can't. How can you? There are no formulas. Yeah, death has to be timed properly. Which is not very difficult. We are not talking about timing up to second. I mean, if the Lagna is accurate, we are all set. The Rashi Chakra,
Lagna in Rashi Chakra is accurate where also. So, there is a good chance that if somebody is around, somebody passes away in death, it's different. But if somebody is around, people are around when somebody passes away, you can know the Punya Chakra. Okay. Any other questions on this class or previous classes? If you forget everything, that's not a question. Any questions? Any chart that you saw recently that you want to discuss? You guys haven't seen any charts in the last month and a half when I was away? Huh? Sure. Okay. Not Bujji, Padme Bujji, just Madhu. So, 1963, September 16, 10:40 a.m., 5 hours, Sikandrabad, 5 hours 30 minutes east of GMT, 78 degrees 30 minutes east, 17 degrees 27 minutes north. This is another chart given by Jeshu. And one more Sikandrabad born chart. I think half of Sikandrabad is special relatives. Okay, so the Lagna is 3 degree 3 minutes Scorpio and moon is at 10 degree 6 minutes 10 degree 6, 7 minutes Leo. Okay, so what do we want to see? Yeah. You? Okay. Yeah. Good. That is very good. See, this is the problem, this is the drawback of germs, etc. However carefully you look, there may be some area of life which may be affected adversely. For example, in this case, moon is the 9th lord and sun is the 10th lord and both of them are in the 10th house. So there is a Rajoga between 9th lord and 10th lord in the 10th house. And in general, 9th lord's jami is relatively a safe thing to wear, in general. Right? Now, one second. And if you look from nakshatra, moon is in Magha nakshatra. So, again from Magha, moon will be the Kshematara lord. So again, Tara wise also it is a safe jump to wear. Now if you look at the Navamsa, which is actually the key to the fortune in life. In Navamsa also, moon is the Lagna lord in Lagna. So again, Pearl is a very safe jump to wear. But, if you look at the Dashamsa, first of all actually, career wise, if you look in the Rashi chart itself, the 10th lord sun is in the 10th house, he is with moon, there is a Rajoga, but moon is also Bhadaka. So Bhadaka is affecting the 10th lord in 10th house. Yeah, that's okay, that's fine. He can show some instability with respect to career, but more importantly, Bhadaka is affecting the 10th lord, can actually show some trouble. Now, that is not enough though. Look at the Dashamsa. If you want to see how a gem will be for career, specifically, look at Dashamsa. In the Dashamsa, Leo is the rising sign. Moon is the 12th lord of losses and instability and changes, etc. Pardon me? In the 4th house of direction, etc. So, 12th lord in the 4th house, debilitated, is not really a great planet as far as career chart is concerned. He actually can show
instability, unhappiness, some loss of direction, some confusion, etc. He has the chance to show those results, right? And unfortunately, that is what he gave. This is the problem. The thing is, if you wear a gem, you may expect certain results. They may also happen, but either before them or after them, something else may also happen. Because it's very difficult to look at all the divisions and see what are the impacts. Something may happen to your mother, your father, or your son, your wife. So many things are possible. So, gems are a rajasic remedy. When you wear them, there are drawbacks. You just have to beware. But despite this, moon the 12th lord in the 4th house, he can give some instability, some confusion, but he doesn't really destroy anything. I mean, he is, at the end of the day, one moksha trikona lord in another moksha trikona. So all may actually end up being for good. Even though he is debilitated, he is an Arun Lagna. But he is very weak. Anyway, it's not bad actually to have moon in the 4th house. So some instability immediately may have resulted from it. But this may not destroy the career. This may actually end up being okay for the career. End up giving her some relaxation basically in the long run. So this may not actually be a bad thing. But looking at the Rashi physically as well as the Navamsya particularly, moon is really fine. So wearing pearl is not really a bad idea at all. She can put it back. Only thing is, this kind of some initial setbacks in career are possible. Secondly, there are some good, there is a little bit of bad also. The reason the bad was pronounced may be that the pearl is probably not really perfect. Or the making, when it was made, there is some imperfection. The person who made it, just imagine, what if the jewelry maker fought with his boss or with his father or somebody, and when he was fighting, he made that and yeah, that will be transferred into it. So there is some impurity in the either in the gem or in the ring itself, the process of making it, or the day she wore it, the time she wore it, there was some bad yoga. Maybe she did not wear it at the right time, because there are so many factors. Unfortunately, we can't control all of them sitting here. So there is something that went wrong. The only thing that can compensate when you are doing something rajasic, when some factor, some parameter goes wrong, the only thing you can do is pray. So along with wearing the pearl, she actually prays to moon. Now she has taken it off, right? If she has to wear it again, keep it in her puja room for a few days, and then do 10 days, and then do Chandra Stotram, or if she doesn't know anything, Om Chandraya Namah, Om Chandraya Namah, Om Chandraya Namah, like that. Or from the Navagraha Stotram, what is it? Dadhyanka Tushara Abham, Shriyodhano Sambham, Namah, that sloka. That sloka, if she can read that Chandra sloka from the Navagraha Stotram, or if she knows the Veda mantra, Aapyayaso Samayasde that mantra, or simply Om Chandra, or Chandra Stotram, or some prayer of Chandra, if she repeats for a considerable time, like 15 minutes, 20 minutes, 30 minutes, like that, every day for 10 days, keeping it in her puja room, and then wears it on a Monday, around sunrise time basically. I mean, still the muhurta may or may not be good, but I think we can't really give her a muhurta from here. But you can at least say on a Monday at the sunrise time, again after praying for 15 minutes, wear it. If she wears it, it may not really be that bad. It will give her fortune. It may give some initial setback in the career, some instability in the career, but finally it should give her fortune. Because he's the 9th lord in Rashi, he is a Navamsya Lagna. Navamsa Lagna Lord in Navamsa. It should open up her fortune. So it is actually a good gem for her. If she supplements it by praying to moon, it will be good. Anything else? So what job does she do? Manager. So son-in-law. Okay. So probably Dashyanta Lagna is right. Because it's on the border, I saw. Pardon me? Oh, we rectified actually. I was wondering, because we are saying based on the Dashyanta Lagna is on a border. So I was wondering if it is right. You see, it sounds right from what you are saying. Good. Okay. Probably because your son also does Kali. No, I'm just kidding. Okay, that's fine. You suggested she's doing, so let her do. Oh, he's a Palan Devata. No, he can't be Palan Devata. Because Saturn is Amatikarka, if I remember right. Saturn is Amatikarka, Kali cannot be the Palan Devata. Oh, actually, he is. You are right. Six from Saturn is owned by Saturn himself. So Kali is a Palan Devata. That's why you suggested Kali. That is good. That is very good. He can continue, no problem. Not only that, the Samsa chart also, see, if you look in the Rashi, the A6 is important for service. In the Rashi, A6 is in Saturn sign. Saturn is in the third house in own sign. So Saturn is important that way. And Saturn is Amatyakarka, who shows career. And he is the Palanadevata planet. And in Dashamsa, he is in the 10th house, in a friendly sign. And he is the 6th and 7th Lord in the Samsa. So he is a very good planet. So based on several factors, praying to Kali is actually a good idea for her. Actually. No problem at all. She can continue. Green. Apart from being the mantra of Kali, it's basically a mantra that starts with Ka Akshara, and that is the Akshara of Mars. Ka is Angarka's Akshara, and Angarka is exalted, he is a Yokarka in this chart. Yokarka exalted in the 6th house, the male face. So, mantra starting with Ka are very good for her case. So, cream is fine. So, that's fine. Different planets rule over different letters. And in general, the Kavarga is ruled by Mars. Kakha, Gagha, that group is ruled by Mars. Cha Cha, Ja Ja, that Varga is ruled by Venus. Tatha, Dadhana, Tatha, Dadhana, that Varga, alveolar sounds. Those are ruled by Mercury. And Tatha Dadhana, the dental sounds, they are ruled by Jupiter. Papha Babhama, the Voshchas, the labial sounds, they are ruled by Saturn. And within each, again, basically this is the Agni, Jala, the Panchabhutas basically. The five Vargas are mapped to the five Vargas. And Moon rules over Yara, Lava, Sahasaha, the semi-vowels, etc. And Sun rules over the consonants. Vowels. I-E-U, all the vowels. So the thing is, and within this Kakha, Gagha, Chacha, Jajha, etc., there are five letters in each Varga. So one is ruled by a Tattva, Sub Tattva basically. Kakha, Gagha are basically Agni Tattva, Chacha, Jajha are Jala Tattva, Tata, Dadha are Bhu Tattva, Tata, Dadha are Aga Tattva, Papa, Babha are Vayu Tattva. Within this, there is a Purusha. For example, Ka, Cha, Ta, Tapa are Purushas. Then Kha, Cha, Tha, Tha, Pha, that is another group. Ka, Ga, Ja, Da, Da, Ba, those are one group. Gha, Ja, Dha, Dha, Ba, one group. And then Annaska. So again, those five are ruled by, again, there is a sub-ruler. And the thing with Ka is, the ruler as well as the sub-ruler is Mars. So it's a Pakka Mars song, Ka. Yeah, same five. So the thing is, any mantra that starts with Ka, a hard Ka sound, is very, it basically activates Mars. So this is a good mantra. The simple Vanakshara mantra, Bijakshara, is good for her. Let her do that. Starting? What is the star of the person? What is your star? Anuradha? Okay, tomorrow what time? 1:30 you will get up and start something. In Delhi? No, not Delhi. Darshan, Darshan, I forgot your town. That's why I asked. Dharam, New Hampshire. So the question is July 1, 2008, 4:30 AM. 4:30 AM in Durham, New Hampshire, 70 degrees 55 minutes 37 seconds west, 43 degrees 8 minutes 2 seconds north, 4 hours west of GMT. So is this good for starting a new meditation with a new mantra? Which god would is that mantra? Narsimha. So is this a good time to start a Narsimha mantra? So that is the question. Okay. First of all. Yeah. See, the thing is, for any mantra, mantra sadhana, the main thing is, the most important thing is fifth house, of course. Lagna and 5th house and 9th house are always important prime. Especially for mantra, the 5th house is important. So 5th lord has to be strong. 5th lord is in Lagna. Only worry is he is with sun. 5th lord is afflicted by sun. That is the only worry. Right? But another thing is the karaka for all mantras is Jupiter. And Jupiter is strong in his own sign. He has a close aspect on Venus. Very close aspect on Venus. And between Sun and Venus there is some distance. And moreover, this is a friendly sign for Venus. Moreover, there is a parivartana between Moon and Mercury and Venus. So it will work as though Mercury is a Lagna with Sun and Venus is with exalted Moon in the 12th house. It will act like that. So it's not bad. And the thing is, the result that you experience from the mantra, if you are looking for a material result, then you look at that house and that house should be strong. Suppose you want to destroy enemies, then 6th house should have natural malefics, etc. But if you are doing just for your own spiritual upliftment, then the main thing is 8th and 12th houses. 8th house shows the sadhana that you do with that mantra. You want to do tremendous sadhana. And any mystical experiences you have with a mantra are from the 8th house. And finally, the detachment that you develop as a result of practicing the mantra is from the 12th house. That is the real goal of any mantra. 12th house is the real goal. So 12th house has to be fortified. And here, the 12th house contains an exalted planet. And there is a parivartana between Lagna Lord and 12th Lord. See, earlier, today we talked about Lagna Lord, 12th Lord being Lagna Lord in 12th and 12th Lord in Lagna, and Venus basically, Venus link. Then, you said, he will spend on dharma karyas. So that combination is there basically. Lagna Lord and 12th is moksha. So moksha sthana and lagna sthana having parivartana in a spiritual sadhana chart is very auspicious. So it seems fine to me. And in addition, the only thing is the 8th house of mystical experiences has Rahu, Mandi, Gulika. So various malefics are in the 8th house. And the 8th Lord Saturn is an inimical sign with another malefic, natural malefic as well as functional malefic, Mars. So there are tremendous malefic influences on 8th house. That is, that what it shows is, it shows some intense experiences. It shows some intense and scary experiences. So this is actually after considering all the factors, my feeling is go ahead. This is good. Go ahead. This may actually be good. Yeah. Right. Right, but unfortunately for longevity, the Varalat is important. This is technically Monday. Tuesday hasn't started yet. So Moon is the Varalat. He is actually in the 12th house. And he is very weak. Krishna Trayodashi, he is basically almost zero. So he is very weak and he is in the 12th house of loss. So I will not be surprised if you actually stop soon. You will do for a while. You have some experience with this, unlike the other mantras. You may actually have some fierce experience with this, and then you may leave it. It is my feeling. But go ahead and try it. No, nothing wrong in it. Sounds good to me. All the best. My only suggestion would be, whatever duration you do it for, whether it is for 10 days or 20 days or 100 days, whatever it is, during that time, just make it a rule, like non-negotiable basically. You must do at the same time, at the same place, facing the same direction. And more importantly, even if you are in one particular day, you have a fever or you have cold or you don't feel like doing, or your body is weak, or you have a leg aches or something. Because those things do happen, especially when you are doing Ugradevata sadhana, a fierce deity worship. The testing will be more abrupt. Swamidevadas will test you very slowly. They will also give results very slowly. But fierce deities, they give results fast and also they test you harsh. So it is like a mother who wants you to succeed very quickly. A mother who doesn't care how quickly you succeed will let you take your own time. She will not interfere that much. But a disciplinarian mother, she will take you to task. So goddesses like Durga and gods like Narasimha, they are like that. They are like quick taskmasters. So he may actually test you. So if you don't pass the test, there's no point in doing it. So you should learn to endure physical pain. If your leg hurts or if your back hurts, just try to forget it. Because the goal of all sadhana is to forget the body. And if some problem of the body becomes an obstruction, that's a shame. You should just forget that there is a body and there is a particular feeling in the body. And try to do that. Especially with this sadhana, it can give results fast. So good luck. Good luck. Okay, so with that, we will end for today. And Om Shanti 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 Sarvam Shri Krishnarpanamastu.